Welcome to the session on effective communication. And the segment that we are going to talk about today is group discussion first, and then we will move on to interview skills. What is group discussion? We already know. What is interview? That also we already know. But should we take care of these things as a part of selection process or as a promotion activity? That is something which we must let our students, our participants know. We normally talk about these things as technical communication, business communication, effective communication as well, which I think is a better word. But they actually are life skills. We have been into group discussions and facing interviews ever since we learned to communicate. What happens when you wish to buy something at your place in your family? Doesn't the entire family get together, discuss things? There are raised emotions, financial accountability. And then perhaps you may have wished to buy a bike which is worth 3 lakh and perhaps settled for that which is 1.5, and if you have been a good negotiator, perhaps you could end up with a Harley Davidson. That is, if your finances allow you for it. So today we should be talking about group discussions. I'll make a quick review of things and then we'll move on to the practical aspects, because as I feel, group discussion and interview skills are actually predominantly life skills. And we do not learn life skills in a laboratory. We learn life skills through practice, and we shall try doing that today. But before that, I have something to ask. You must have discussed, come across the tenets of GD, wherein we have team play, initiative, leadership, listening skills, creativity, and the rest of the things. Let's pause for a moment and look at these. Does any center have any query regarding this? If you do, please hand raise.
Center 1063, over to you.
Critiquing can be a part of one of the points of tenets of GD?
Oh yes, definitely. Why not? It has to be a part, because a GD is not a place where you actually have to talk about the good things. You have to mention what could go wrong and what could be positive. So in a group discussion, but then it should be done in a positive manner. What do you mean by a positive manner? It shouldn't be outrightly rejecting the person's opinion. We are not dealing with a person out there. We are dealing with his opinion, his thought process. So critiquing, again, is an extremely important part of group discussion. So when I say flexibility, perhaps that would come under critiquing as well.
GDs can be in the ongoing lectures also. In a way, what we can do is, for certain engineering topic, mm-hmm. after the discussion, we can ask the students, we can divide the class in two groups, wherein yes. one can work on the advantages and other can work on the disadvantages, and finally it can lead to a discussion later on. So this is what I had implemented many of the times, and the result of it was quite fruitful.
That would be quite fruitful. In fact, since we are onto it, I would suggest there is a book, Six Thinking Hats by Edward D. Bono. Okay? Six Thinking Hats by Edward D. Bono, wherein he talks up the principles of six hats, wherein each hat talks about a different aspect. The black hat would talk about the negatives of that particular topic, of that particular discussion. The yellow would talk about the positive. The red would talk about the danger associated. The blue takes an omnipotent view of the things. So what we could do is, we could actually, and there could be something very interesting. You know, when we divide people into two groups, talking about the advantage and the disadvantage. And if post some time, we could just intermingle them, interchange them, that would again be very interesting. Because the thought process would immediately change. They will have to think on both the sides. So perhaps you could do that also. Try that also. For one part of the GD, you could have some of the people talking about it positively, shift them into the other side, have some other people from the other side, and interchange their thought process.
Center 1178, over to you.
It's a pleasure to take such a guidance under you. And my question is that, what is the difference between brainstorming and group discussion?
Brainstorming, group discussion, if you are having a healthy group discussion, it is like a brainstorming session. When we talk about the board of directors going for a group discussion, it is actually a brainstorming session. Group discussion is the preliminary stage, you could say, for finalizing something, getting towards a meeting. And brainstorming session is something, you could say it is the preliminary stage, and that would be on a later stage.
Center 1111.
Yeah, very good morning, man. The main thing about group discussion, what we feel is that when we start acknowledging other person's views, either by disagreeing or agreeing, it would motivate them to share their views, and it would also give us a way to continue or speak more on their views and to share our views. And our discussion will again motivate others to share their ideas. So the main thing what I feel is acknowledging others' views in a group discussion will pave way for more points.
Perfect. I really appreciate your observation. Because unless and until you develop other person's idea, unless and until you talk about the other person's idea, how would you come to an agreement? So if we could motivate our students to go on for this kind of group discussion, it will really be wonderful. We need to let them know, we need to ascertain that group discussion is not a debate, wherein if we have taken a chance, taken a stance that is firm, and we cannot change it. We should develop other, we should make our students know that in a group discussion, we have to be flexible enough to develop other person's idea as well. Thank you.
Center 1294, over to you.
Can you distinguish between group player and team player, ma'am?
Well, in a team, when you talk about group discussion, group play and team play, they are one and the same thing. If you say group discussion, within that, if you say team play, it definitely is a tenet of group discussion. Why? Because in a team play, the most active member of the team, the person who comes across as the initiator or the leader of the group, must see to it that the quieter member of the group also participate in the discussion. It is not necessary always that the most active member would have the best of suggestions. So when you're talking about team play, every person is equal out there. It is the opinion that matters. Please always remember, it is not the person that we are evaluating out there. And so, although we put emphasis on communication skills during any kind of communication, in a group discussion, in a brainstorming session, as one of the group had said, it is extremely important that you try to draw out the most reticent member of the group in communication. We are talking about, when you say team play and group play, we are actually talking about synonyms out there. Okay, so let's go on to another center.
Center 1235, over to you.
Ma'am, we have a general query which is prevailing among our students while attending their group discussion. Mm-hmm. The body gesture or their position, how they should maintain it, ma'am, throughout the GD, whether they should be very flexible or they should have an erect position throughout the GD. Because some HRs, they prefer the first option and some others go for the second one. So there's a common confusion about it.
in a group discussion, please do not be very aggressive. It certainly depends on the HR. It certainly depends on them what kind of persona, what kind of people they want in their group. But please do not be extremely aggressive, extremely dominant. Also, if you're going for a marketing interview, perhaps a bit of assertion is required in your tone, in your body language. If it is a fish market, everybody is talking, everybody is shouting. It does not necessarily mean that being high on Langpa, you will all be selected. Certainly not. But yes, if you have been high on Langpa and you have brought logical conclusion to the discussion, then perhaps the chances are you would be selected. The bottom line is, in a group discussion, your body language has to be assertive, not aggressive. You have to come across as somebody who puts a point across, allows people to build on that point, does not rattle with that point, does not keep on giving the points without developing it. We have often come across here also in IIT, we have often come across people saying it was such a dynamic, it was such a vociferous discussion and none of us got into it. Not everybody would want a very aggressive set of people amongst them.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you. We have another question too. Mm-hmm. In some cases, some of our students also come from rural background. Right. They have a lot of ideas to be exposed, but in their own colloquial language. Mm-hmm. While we compel them to speak in English, they are not coming forward. So what is the solution for this problem, ma'am?
Well, they'll have to start a little early. That is before their placement session. You'll have to work with them a little early. But let us suppose they have not prepared and they have to be there. Okay, in the group discussion for the placements or whatever. I often tell them, and it really works out well with those kind of students, tell them to raise their hands. Okay, tell them to raise their hands. The group and the moderator would have already gathered that person is not conversant with the English language. So tell him to raise hands and then request for a 2-minute uninterrupted break. And then ask him to present his ideas. That would be an exceptional case where he should not just present one idea if he has several. If he has several ideas, ask him to present 2, 3, 4 good ideas in those 2 minutes. And if somebody tries to interrupt, tell him to again raise his hands, because you know, at the end of it, in a group discussion, you have to talk. Unless and until you have said something, you have spoken, you cannot dream of cracking it.
Center 1182, over to you.
Good morning, please,
ma'am.
Carol.
There's a question. Mm-hmm. For placement interviews, when students appear for group discussion, mm-hmm. It is said that giving examples, facts, figures makes your opinion more strong. Mm-hmm. But if the fact, figure, or an example is somewhere related to the past, maybe from mythology or epics, will that example do? Taking an example from mythology or epic, will it do?
It would depend on the topic. What kind of a topic is it? Is it related to current affairs? If it is related to current affairs, we should abstain from giving such examples. But if the topic is vast, give that example. At the same time, be ready that if the discussion digresses from the topic, because there would be someone who would come up with a new story. And there may be a third person who would come up with another story. So that person who has placed that example should be prepared to bring the discussion back. Facts and figures, since you've already raised the issue, please be absolutely sure about your facts and figures in a group discussion, because what happens, we've generally noticed in group discussion, especially for the placement interviews, if you go wrong by even a decimal, there is somebody to rebut you. So if you are rebutted out there, obviously your credentials goes down in the eye of the moderator. So just be very sure if you're using the facts and figures, just be very sure or use approximation out there. Okay? This looks like a very healthy group. This, I think the participation is quite high. How high is the participation? How many of you there?
44.
Oh, wow. Good morning, everybody. Good morning. I guess you should get some bonus. We have asked several questions, and unless and until we do some practical about it, as I said, we won't learn any life skill. Should I give you a topic to discuss as a group discussion? Would you have the yeah? So what we could do is, may I have six of you volunteering for that particular topic for group discussion? Should I give you the topic also?
Yeah, we'll do.
Okay, so what we require to do in the next 15 minutes is, six of you from your center will discuss the topic which I am going to give you. Please arrange the chairs in a semicircle manner so that all the other centers, the 118 centers that we have, all of them will be focused on you. Right? Would you have mics, extra mics as well, or is it the single mic that you're distributing out there?
Because we we'll arrange for it.
Somebody would do it. Please get into a group of 8. Okay? And the topic is quite interesting. Mumbai Literature Festival is on, and one of the topics to be discussed in Mumbai Literature Festival is, we should have the right to offend. We should have the right to offend. How does the topic sound?
Ma'am.
Yes?
Offend in what sense? Offend what? We are not getting. It will become more generalized.
You could go about the topic any which way. Okay? So, may I request all the other centers to act as the interviewer or the moderator who would be taking notes on what was good, what was very good, what could have improved. And Sholapur, may please come up with 8 participants, all drawn in a semicircle, and we would go about a group discussion for the next 15 minutes. Please be very watchful, because it is your own peer group which is in a group discussion out there. And perhaps when you would see them in a group discussion, you would realize as to what you have to tell your students. The participants may please feel absolutely free and
let's
work.
Focus the camera on the participants.
Yeah, the camera has to be on the participants. And you'll be talking amongst yourselves. It is a group discussion. Your topic is, we should have the right to offend. And you would be talking amongst yourself. Okay? The camera is going to take care of things, but you would be talking amongst yourself, please. I just hope all the other centers are also ready, because you have to watch them for the logical thinking process, for the body language, and how things are moving in it. Now, I guess there's just one mic and they would be distributing it, so perhaps it won't come as a coordination, so we are not going to focus out there. But please focus on rest of the things. Thank you. Go ahead.
Okay. Good morning all. The topic that we have been given for the group discussion is, we should have the right to offend. And I initiate the group discussion by saying that looking at the present scenarios wherein people come up with unpleasant remarks or unpleasant behavior at whatever is happening, maybe in society, against politicians and all. So somewhere it's coming up with a bad face in the society. So one should have a right to offend, but in what manner that has to be checked upon, not in a harsh or a brutal way.
When we are giving the, or any politician giving the statement in the news or media, they should require to take care about not hurt the any people's any people or any society. That is my point.
Good morning all. This is a very interesting topic which we have got, and I appreciate what you have said. And what I think about this topic is, actually this topic is related to, I mean, whatever present scenario is happening right now in the society. We have a very interesting example of Mr. Aamir Khan, who is a, who we all call him as a perfectionist, and he has raised his voice against, you know, whatever happening or intolerance. Regarding that, he raised his voice and he just expressed what he felt. And what I think is that as per the constitution, I think we have got the right to say what we I mean what we feel, and that is what I think Aamir Khan has done. And I think it is completely valid that yes, we should have right to offend. Rather, I should say that instead of saying we should have right to offend, we can also say that we have the right to defend against something. If something is if something bad is happening in the society, right, it's everybody's responsibility, as this is a democracy, it's everybody's responsibility that we should raise, as a citizen, we should raise a voice against that. And it's complete that, yes, we should have right to offend against something which is bad happening in society. What do you think about this?
Thank you, sir, for your views. But I would like to differ in the sense that we come across many things in our daily life, that people eating pan and spitting, or say you are eating something in train and just throwing your dishes outside the window. So looking at such instances, you feel like you want to offend that person by saying something, or just you feel like slapping him. But if you think it deeply, as Gandhiji has said, that he hate the sin and not the sinner. You can think of offending in different ways. Not like hitting or saying bad words or talking bad things on the back. So you have very creative ways to make the other person before you realize his mistake.
Good morning. I do agree with madam that there should be ethical ways to offend. I mean, we should not offend on the emotions of others. We should not hurt others while offending. So it should be in a diplomatic way. I think so. What do you think?
Good morning all. So my answer is attack is the best way to defend. And definitely in one way, currently the society is evolving and revolving around the comments made by our politicians and by our different stars. So my view is attack is the best way to defend, and definitely I am in favor of right to offend.
My thought regarding this is there is some rules that is required to make the statement. In the such statement like Aamir Khan made that statement, there are some rules by the government, and anybody not able to do the statements which causes the war situation in the society.
Absolutely agree with you, sir. Making a literally a bold statement that may hurt the sentiments of the general public, and a responsible person or a person who holds a good or what do you say, a role model before a society, should be really careful while using such words. Offending in the sense like you can go for coming up with protest, but in a mild way, rather than hurting or what we say, damaging the national property or so. Or some, we nowadays we find okay, any reporter comes up and slaps away a politician. So maybe somewhere we even find that society is somewhere the line has been crossed that they can't bear it. So to when this line is crossed out, people start behaving or offending in a violent way. But somewhere this has to be curbed, because this totally changes the state of mind of other people. It affects a whole lot, a majority of people of a nation.
Well, I appreciate what you have said, and I appreciate the rest of the people who have given the very valid points. However, there are certain issues which I came across when you were speaking. I think he raised, Mr. Kangleser raised a very valid point that yes, one should think of others and one should think of the emotion of the society when you are giving something or when you are offending, right? And sir said that attack is the best defense, and he said that like warlike situation we have to, I mean, avoid. However, if we want to, I mean, if we want to offend, at that time we have law and order, as rightly mentioned. Like we can have a protest, and for protest also in the law, in the law or in the constitution, they have given the parameters which we can follow, and then we can protest. And that is the true way. Instead of becoming violent and disturbing, instead of disturbing the society, we can I mean, we can follow the law and order. And if we follow the constitution, the rest of the things will be very easy. It's a kind of guide for the entire, I mean, India, like in what way we can offend, right? That's what I think.
Actually, according to Hello. Actually, according to my view, it depends upon totally on the situation wherein you are. Certain situations and conditions where rules should be followed, and if rules are openly broken, then we should offend. For example, such as if we want to go to some place, we should go in line to ride a bus, to take the reservation, and act accordingly. But people are, as you have seen, a situation wherein they rush. At that time, you have to be strict and hard at the reservations and all. So it becomes, but suppose if somebody is sitting on a place which is reserved for ladies, then the person sitting on that should have the courtesy to get himself up rather than getting him reminded. So such situations which cannot be tolerated, there we should offend. And other positions where we can take it to a more lightly and in more collaborative manner, there we should not offend. So it it clearly depends upon the situation, what is I feel.
Hello, sir. Many times what happens, such kind of a situation came, and because of that, what we have to do, we have to react. Actually, what we have to do, we have to think on that situation, and then we have to instead of reacting, we have to think on that situation, and according to that, we have to give the response. So actually, response must be a proper thinking process instead of reaction. So that is me.
Okay, I agree with you, sir. I think so. Indian history has taught us a very great lesson. That was a freedom struggle wherein we fought against the Britishers, but in a non-violent way. Okay, a right lesson to be followed and preserved by Indians, that yeah, offended, but in a right manner, that no one gets hurt or a bad propaganda doesn't take place.
Very well said, madam. One more point I would like to add here, and that is now right now what is happening in Syria, we all are aware, right? The people offended against the system over there. However, they chose the path which was very violent one, and as rest of the world can see right now, and rest of the world can feel also the repercussions of what has happened in Syria. And when we are offending at the time, we should take care that such kind of repercussions should not be there in the system. Or even if there are problems, no country is a perfect country. No system is a perfect system. We people, as Indians, we make this system, I mean, we try to achieve the perfection, right? There are flaws. However, as I previously mentioned, like we should take care that we are following the constitution. And as Madam rightly said, like we should punish the sins, not the sinner. And if we follow that these two things, I think, yes, we will offend in the right way. And that's why I said, like, yes, we should have a right to offend. And that's it. Yes.
I agree, sir. But people come up with their own interests. And it's up to us whom to follow and whom not to follow. So, I think we should be more mature in the sense that somebody is saying we should interrogate ourselves and we should follow the person with national interest, not on his own interest. I think so.
Definitely, considering the current situation, we can see there are plenty of comments made in general life by many of famous personalities. So, and the people are getting incited or people are feeling offended by their comments. And definitely it creates a situation where the society has to face the results. Means it will result in violence, it will result in destroying some public properties. And so my view is we need to have constructive offense. So the people need to develop their own mind to digest that, and it will be a healthy society if people had means will develop their mindset to this kind of comment. Definitely we need to answer in constructive way.
I agree with sir. Yeah, but we all are discussing like, yeah, we need to offend to something that's happening bad, something that's not good for us. And the way we need to offend, we need to change those ways. When we should start inculcating it, just saying that, yeah, we need to offend in a peaceful way is not sufficient. So it needs to start inculcating in an individual right from family, right from the education system. So this is the basis where an individual learns how to offend. Yeah, speak up. It's your right to speak up. Put it up. Put right things in a right way, right manner. Offend things happening bad in the society. Just don't be blind towards what's happening around you. But somewhere it has to be inculcated in us right from our education system.
Well, I think we'd go for the conclusion now. It's almost 15 minutes, so we'd request a conclusion.
Okay, having a discussion on the topic, we should have the right to offend. All my friends, colleagues gave up a good input towards it. Like we begin, yeah, many incidents are taking place wherein they are offended, but in a wrong way, in a harsh manner. So somewhere this has to be changed. The manner you offend things has to be changed. You have to be polite. You have to be somewhere gentle in your manner, like carrying out mild protests against things that are happening. Yeah, but we should have a right to offend in a right manner.
Should have a right to offend. Where basic rights are being encroached, then we have right to offend it. That is what I think.
Okay. Thank you very much for enthusiastic participation and a well-defined discussion. Now, I'll go to other centers to get the feedback from your peer group. Okay? So, let me select something at random. And then perhaps I'll give my feedback to you.
Center 1016, over to you.
Discussion was very good. Mm-hmm. We also agree that we should have the right to offend. But I have certain opinion on this.
Yeah, one thing I would request out here. Let your opinions, let your feedbacks be constructive. And please, the person who were involved in the discussion, will please take things in the positive manner, because that is how we all learn. And perhaps if you will place me in a group discussion, there will be time when even I would falter. So please take everything in the right spirit. Go ahead.
my opinion is we should offend if something is happening wrong with our society or ethics. But who offends and in what way is equally important. When the celebrities or politicians try to talk on something, whether good or bad, then it affects the society a lot than what a common man says. And the way it is said or way it is taken in the society matters a lot.
Yeah.
So finally, I would like to say that one should have the right to offend, but in a proper way.
Okay, perfect, perfect. Now, may I request your opinion on the participants of the group discussion? What did you like about the group discussion that they had? Because we are going to have a give our feedback on them, and that is how we are going to learn. So, what do you think? I mean, we are going to polish. We all know things about group discussion. We are just going to polish ourselves. So, what is your opinion about the participants who participated in the group discussion? If you had to select one, who would you have selected? And if you had to select two, who would you have selected? And why?
Group discussion was nice, and every person in the group tried to answer in that situation.
Mm-hmm.
And
so would you select all? Let us suppose you were the HR of some big firm. Would you select all of them? You have to take just two people. You have come for the placement interview and you have to select just two people. Who and why?
I would like to say the person who concluded that we should offend the sin, not the sinner, mm-hmm. has to be actually appreciated.
Okay. And who was that?
He was actually the person who was beside the person who initiated the talk.
Okay, I got it. Thank you. Shall we move to some other center now?
Center 1147, over to you.
You saw the group discussion?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
I've seen the discussion, ma'am. Ma'am, I have some doubts regarding that group discussion.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, the topic discussed by the group members, no one is saying that... what is the real meaning of offend?
Okay.
For example, mostly they are talking about the sensitive topic of politics.
Mm-hmm.
So the offend means not only in the politics,
mm-hmm.
that we have to offend individual and we have to offend in many ways.
Mm-hmm.
And one more question I have,
mm-hmm.
and all other participants,
mm-hmm.
and they are not speaking in loud manner. I don't think so, because whether any technical problem in the center. I don't think so. They are not talking aloud. And one more thing that I want to say here, the conclusion and the initiator, and they are talking in a different way. Talking about the offend in a different way, but one sir is talking about in some other way. So no one is saying that that I have to talk in something. They are saying that yes, whatever that one topic is discussed, they are all saying this. They have to say something in the different manner. So they said simply, I welcome this. And I'm really, whatever sir says is, I'm okay that he's saying like this. So that I need the discussion, the group discussion should be a healthy one. So that means that they have to say something different regarding the topic.
I think there were a few differences, but we'll come to it again. You made a very interesting point, interesting observation, and the first point that you made, the definition of offend, the other centers would also please take into account that particular thing. The topic has to be defined. First and foremost, the topic has to be defined. Let's go to some other center.
Center 1323, over to you.
I have one question, please. I have one question to your center. Who did you think was the initiator? Who did you think was the leader of the group discussion?
The one gentleman sitting second to the right. He has started.
Okay, and why? Why do you think so?
And also, our offending voice should bring something good to the society. It should not create any violence.
Okay. Perfect, perfect. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Phenolex Academy, over to you.
Madam, at the outset, we appreciate the participation and initiative of all the group members. According to us, the group leader is the person sitting in between the two ladies. But the major problem with the group discussion is that they started with a particular stance. Initially, they should state the purpose, they should derive the methodology, and then they should announce the problem. While announcing the problem, they need to again state all the facts. And with the third step only, they need to carry out the actual discussion, wherein we actually add the new values. And finally, while summarizing, we need to restate all the points, and then we should arrive. They started with the stance as well as with the particular facts that should be avoided. In a way, it is not at all properly structured. But we really appreciate the efforts and initiative taken by the group members.
Perfect. Perfect. Thank you so much for your observation. It's impeccable, wonderful observation. And if you had to select, who would you have selected and why?
The person sitting at the center in between the two ladies.
Okay.
Who was really enthusiastic and actually provided the direction for the discussion.
Okay. So, it was an extremely important point. We'll go to one other center, but this is one point which must be borne in mind when we interact with our students with respect to group discussion. The direction has to be given. Whosoever gives the direction to the group discussion is actually the leader, you could say the initiator as well. Let's go to a couple of other centers and then we come back and give a feedback.
Center 1176, over to you.
The lady who was sitting at the center,
okay,
initiated the discussion,
mm-hmm,
but however, the gentleman who was sitting to left of her,
right,
took the lead,
mm-hmm,
and he was trying to bring out a consensus,
right,
but in our feeling, what we felt was a consensus did not emerge. Now that leads to a question, if a group discussion is not able to hammer out a consensus,
mm-hmm,
how to come out with the conclusion? That is a question from my side, madam.
Okay, we'll take that question also. So let's move on to other center, the last one.
KIT College, over to you.
Your observation on the discussion, please.
Yeah, madam. The person who was sitting in between two ladies was the person who took the initiative. His body language was extremely good. He was speaking very well about the and giving very well direction.
Mm-hmm.
What I feel that others were giving their views and not involving in group discussion. Each one were having their separate views, but mm-hmm, no one speak about the same point twice. And the last person, that the first person from left, he tried to conclude, but he was not in the group discussion. That is what I feel.
Okay. All the centers we randomly selected. Thank you so much for your feedback. They are very important and coming from the peer group, you relate more with the feedback. So let's move on to the first center, the center that had participated in the group discussion. Shall we move on to it? Well, thank you so much. It was a very healthy, wonderful group discussion and you would have come across the feedback from, yes, that's really great. You would have come across the feedback. It was actually an ideal situation and perhaps had all the ingredients that we wish to talk about in a group discussion. So what happens is, the lovely lady in the center, she took the initiation. She took the initiation and the gentleman next to her, in fact, both the gentlemen participated really actively in the group discussion. But the gentleman, with a white shirt, I guess. It's a white shirt, right? Yes. If you go back and see the recording now, you would see that the group discussion got a start. It was barely laid on the table with what we felt is the initiator. She did it. She did a good job. But in a group discussion, the words have to be dealt in such a manner that every participant understands what has to be discussed. The topic has to be discussed in such a meaningful manner. It has to be discussed in a proper manner for everybody to understand. So when he came across, he said, he in fact went ahead with a bang. He said, right to offend, yes, but we can also portray it as a right to defend. That was a tagline, a catchline. Right to defend. And then what he does is, he gives his viewpoint. The only thing I would request you, sir, professor, out here is that when you said, when we teach our participants, we usually do not trust a responsibility of going ahead with the discussion because that participant may not be ready at that particular moment to talk about it. So what we need to do is, I have talked about it earlier also, when you are trying to close your point, you are nearing a closure, and if you want the lady to start or if you want somebody to take the initiative to start post you, your eyes should do the trick. Okay? What you do is, you do this, and if this is the person you want to be the next, let your eyes groove on that particular person. Stay there for a few seconds. If the person doesn't respond, it is open to the forum. So that is how we draw in the more reticent people in our group discussion. Why? If let us suppose somebody is a Professor Sinha out here, and I've just made a point. And then I say, now Professor Sinha, would you like to say something about it? Professor Sinha has no clue what he wants to say. Okay? So he will be a little ruffled out there. Or she will be a little ruffled out there. And that doesn't go down well with the moderator. Okay? So we'll not put the person in a tight situation. But you had, what you did was, yes, what you did was the initiating part. So that made you the initiator. That made you the leader. So what we need to tell our students is, don't scramble to start a group discussion. And if you have not, despite all your thought process, if you feel that someone else has started and you have not got the chance, please don't feel let down. Maybe that person has not given the right direction to the group discussion. So he or she doesn't become the initiator if you made a better pitch in your second or the third entry. Okay, a group discussion is not there merely for the sake of group discussion. A group discussion is there because something must come out of it. So, like there were two other centers who chose you as the initiator. That was because you waited for the opportunity. It was a group discussion, not by the students, but by professors, and obviously the decorum was fantastic. So what you did was, you waited for your turn, and when you came back, once you built up on a point someone else had mentioned, that was one category which again went for you. You gained another point as a team player. You have already been the initiator, you have already been the leader. But in order to be the leader throughout, you have to maintain certain, you have to take care of certain other tenets. So what you did, you build up on someone else's point, and at the third opportunity, you brought in law and order situation. Let's have a guideline, and the protest should be amicable. So you gave a political aspect to the discussion as well. As the last gentleman, as I think from one of the centers, wherein I said you should keep his observation in mind, he had said it has to be structured. So this was a highly volatile topic. We should have the right to offend. In order to go for it in a structured manner, perhaps what we could have done is, in the very beginning, we could have said it could have socio-cultural dimension, it can have political dimension, it can have religious dimension, economic dimension. So the moment you throw these words at your audience, you know that these are the parameters on which we have to go, on which we have to move ahead. So you have given a vast dimension to this particular thing. Political, how? The award wapsi. We have used the freedom struggle example. We could have also, to show our current affairs awareness, talked about the award wapsi thing that is happening out here. So that would have given a freshness, that would have given some spunk to the discussion. We need to have some spunk also in the discussion. We need to have some, you know, a little raised voice. It cannot be all cozy. Because unless and until we make you get out of that box, you cannot come up with very good suggestions. The person this side, who was the last one on our list, when he made his interjection, he had some very good points. Yes, he had some very good point. So I'd appreciate, we have students who have extremely good points, but they don't talk and they just become aware when it is the last minute. Over here, often they say you should not bring points towards the end of the group discussion. But if you have suddenly come across a point which you think is relevant to it, raise your hand, seek permission, and then say it. So I think this feedback from KJ Somaiya College of Engineering was really good, and we must bear it in mind. The lady definitely, she was very good, and it was wonderful that she participated, because she initiated and gave the vigor to the discussion. The person sitting on your, with the green shirt, the professor with the green shirt again, he had some extremely good points. In fact, all of you made your participation. Yes, all of you made your participation impactful. So, just the few points that your peer group has shared with you and the analysis which finally came across needs to be borne in mind when we are trying to talk with our students. I would now go ahead with another topic. It will be an abstract topic. This was a case-based topic. We'll go to some other center. We'll select another random center. And this time we'll tackle an abstract topic, because in an abstract topic, how the initiation should be done, again, is very important. So thank you very much once again for your efforts. It was wonderful. And we are all from the same background, all professors out here. So let's move on to some other center. Post that, is there any question? We'll take questions for another 5 minutes, and then perhaps we'll go ahead with the with another set of group discussion. Please raise hand.
Regarding the initiator, mm-hmm. I wanted to know how important is the opener for the group discussion?
Extremely important, dear. Extremely important. Because he is the one who actually sets the tone of the group discussion. So we should not jump. We should tell our students not to jump at the occasion. If only he or she is comfortable with the topic, let the person initiate, or otherwise let someone else who is more comfortable with the topic initiate the discussion. Also, as I said, if the person who thought himself to be the initiator does not make a proper introduction, the second person has absolute right to talk about the topic, not repeating himself or herself, to talk about the topic and see that every member of the group understands it. Because unless and until the topic is understood by everybody, like long back we had a group discussion and the topic was euthanasia, then this word was not popular. So most of the students did not understand what euthanasia was. One of the person who knew the word initiated, and then the group discussion followed. In this case, what would offend mean? That had to be told. The vast ambit of the word offend had to be introduced to the group. So the role of the initiator is extremely important. Many a times it so happens that several entries are being made in the selection process. That is what we see. Maybe if in a group of 8, 4 entries may have been made and yet the introduction has not come. So in many cases, even the 5th person who acts, who talks and gives a proper introduction becomes an initiator, or he becomes an initiator or a leader, a touted leader for the group. So please, we need to tell our students, don't jump just to mention anything to be the initiator. We all were quite impressed with the person who came either second or the third entry. His was the third entry. We all were quite impressed. And if somebody had to make just one selection, perhaps you'd have selected him. He was not the initiator. But eventually with his points, with his demeanor, and the way he presented them and built up on other people's point, we thought he would be the safest bet for our company. Is that okay?
Speaking with respect to the constitutional background, would have been selected in it because it's about right to offend. So if a person would have spoken about right to freedom in that context, would that be the right thing as the initiator? If the discussion would have started with that, talking about the Article 19, which talks about freedom of speech, would that have been the best way to start it?
Yeah, we could start it. It depends on how it progresses. So as an introduction, it would have been good. It would have shown the person in a more enlightened manner. There could be, we cannot say that this is the best kind of introduction. It would depend on the personality. We cannot have a foolproof thing, but what you said is definitely brilliant.
It is crucial with respect to right to freedom of speech. So setting the context in that regard?
It's okay, but right to offend, when we say right to offend, that definitely gives you a freedom, but the freedom comes with a baggage. It comes with a, with the right to freedom of speech, we also have our directive principles. So if you go into the right to freedom, that brings in directive principles also, the fundamental rights and directive principles. So how you would tackle it, there could be somebody, the moment you talk about the right to freedom or fundamental rights, there would be somebody who would talk about the directive principles as well, which is equally important. So it depends on how it shapes. A group discussion, perhaps if I give this group discussion to some other group, they would tackle it in a completely different manner. So what we need to do is, how many in a group discussion, what we need to do or what we need to look at is how many points have been made, have the points been developed, has the group come across as a team player, which the group had come. The participating group had come as a team player. So this is something which we need to know. And what is the conclusion? Have they led it towards a conclusion? Yes?
One more question, madam. In a group discussion, as you said, there would be some one leader or initiator. But if it is a question of getting selected in some interview and we are carrying out the group discussion, then there, in order to show oneself, one would be, rather there would be too many initiators. So in that case, that will be a competition or a sort of clash. So in which case, who will be rather what will be the appropriate action to be taken?
That is what we really want in a group discussion. When we are making a selection and we have, let us say, 8 students who are quite vociferous, very intelligent, and if unfortunately we have to take only 2, right? So that is when we really see how actively they have participated and how they have behaved with the other person's viewpoint. That is one point. Many a times you would see that in your college placements, one entire group is selected, the entire group has been selected while there have been no selections from some other groups. Why does that happen? Because maybe in that particular group, the students had not only behaved properly, they had come up with very good points, they had built up other people's point. And despite the fight initially, it all settled down into a very wholesome discussion, group discussion. So it happens so many times. A particular group, the entire group gets selected, or maybe out of 7, 5 or 6 have been selected. And that is it. If they had to make 8 selections, they don't go beyond it. So in order to say that you have to shout, you have to make a... Normally what happens is the students go for trainings and all, and over there they teach them to that fish market strategy. That fish market strategy also works at times when there is a cacophony in that particular group discussion. But over there, in your context, whatever you have said, in that context, when there are too many initiators, one of them has to raise his voice or her voice and let them know that this is not a fish market. Let's settle down to a proper group discussion. And believe me, whosoever the moderator is, he's going to take that positively, no matter he shouts at the top of his voice. Because post that, things would settle down and they would come up with a healthy discussion. So the bottom line is, you need to be heard, you need to be heard proper, and you need to make sound references. So just to summarize what we did, the initiator, the person who begins, need not be the initiator. If the topic has not been introduced properly, or if the topic needs further explanation, the second or the third person who follows may make an explicit introduction, post one of his points, and then let it in the open forum. One thing that we really need to, whenever there is an impromptu group discussion, there is the fear of repetition. So we need to tell our students that no matter what, don't repeat your point. Because the moderator is actually taking count of whatever points you've made. So what he would be writing is repetitive, repetitive, repetitive. So let's not make a repetition of the point. Yes, if you're building upon it, go back to it. And the last one, body language is extremely important. And at the same time, there is no hard and fast rule that you cannot get a little cacophonous, a little aggressive in a group discussion. So bearing all these points in mind, go for the group discussion with an open mind. See that everybody is involved. Try involving everybody. And try to get a conclusion. If there is not a conclusion and you still have varied opinion, you have not been able to mold people to your opinion, it doesn't matter altogether. Because a group discussion would always not be a means to a conclusion. You would set certain things apart, and then perhaps there would be another round of group discussion, another round of meeting, and then perhaps you would have a conclusion to it. So in a selection process, what matters for us is that the students should be logical, they should not be repetitive, they should try to be assertive, not aggressive, and if some of the members are reticent, they could raise their hands and they could also raise their voice in order to gain attention. It will not go, they will definitely get noticed, and if they come up with a good point, they will not be marked in the negative. I'll take two more questions and then we shall move on to the interview skills.
Actually, the group discussion starts with the four stages, no? Storming, forming, norming, and performing.
Mm-hmm.
So in that discussion, what happened earlier, the initiator should have opened the topic. She should have given some definition or expansion of the topic, and she should have set the ball rolling, right?
Mm-hmm. Very true.
And then she started with the conclusion. Mm-hmm. That's what happens with the students also.
Mm-hmm.
For example, if I give the like should be wage war against Pakistan, the first or the initiator always says yes or no.
Mm-hmm.
That is again wrong according to me. We are not supposed to conclude at the beginning of the group discussion.
Very true.
Many of them were giving the conclusions even when the discussion was going on.
Okay. So the group will please take that into account. Everybody, all the centers would please take into account.
Yes. And then, my question is, should there be a leader in the group or not? If there is a leader, the leader has to introduce himself or herself and then make the others introduce, and then the discussion should start.
In a formal group discussion, in a corporate group discussion, what happens is, you do know the hierarchy. So in the hierarchy, you know who the leader is. However, the potential of the group discussion rests in a corporate setup, let me tell you. In a corporate setup, the potential of the group discussion rests on how giving the leader is, how unobtrusive the leader is. He would wait for others to make a point. He would dissect those points. He would come up with own points and leave it open-ended. However, in the selection process, we have to train students for the selection process as well. Over there, there is not necessarily a leader. Nobody is a designated leader in a group discussion, because all of us, the moment we have a leader, he is in for the selection. So we cannot have a leader in a group discussion. It is just that the person, by his behavior, by his thought process, and through his points and team building spirit, emerges as a leader in the rest of the eyes. So it is not that somebody who is talking a lot, communicating a lot, will actually be a leader. He could be a facilitator also if he has not brought any point to the discussion, if he has not added to the group discussion. There could be somebody who is seeing that every person participates in a group. But when it comes to himself, he has not made a single revolution, he has not made a single point. He may have built upon the other people's point. So that is one aspect of it, of him or her, that he keeps the group intact. So that doesn't make him a leader, does it? Along with that, if he comes up with points, then perhaps he emerges as a leader. So we cannot have a leader in a group discussion. Even in the corporate setup, there is absolutely no leader. When the group discussion is going on, when the meeting or the brainstorming is going on, the moment we have a leader. Now, we often say with a major corporate, there are two major corporates, Indian-born corporates, who are multinationals. For one, we may say that a group discussion takes place with the topic left open-ended. In the other, the person comes and says, I want this to be done, what is your opinion? The moment the person says, I want this to be done, the discussion doesn't happen. There may be a few brave soul who would say, this is not possible, this could be problematic, this could be problematic. But if the leader has already said, this has to be done, this has to be done. So then it is not a group discussion, it is a diktat, to which they try to give a flavor of group discussion. So what we have to tell the students is, it is an open forum, go make your mark out there. Don't be exaggeratedly aggressive. And if in order to become a leader, you have to bring other people also into the discussion, do it with your eyes. Don't do it by thrusting the mic to the person. Any other question, please?
It should be a global view of the topic also, no ma'am?
We have to take the micro, yes, I think it is there in the slides also. We have to take a micro and the macro view of the situation. Whenever the topic is there, we have to take a micro as well as the macro view. And in fact, it is very interesting. In a group discussion, you may have taken one stance at the beginning of the group discussion, and then suddenly you feel that perhaps what others are talking holds more water. So in that case, you can say, oh, I think I took a micro view of the situation. Taking a macro view, perhaps you are right. Or we need to deliberate upon this issue as you have observed. So that is, you know, it satisfies your ego also. You are not changing stances. You are being flexible, and at the same time, you are letting them know that you took a micro view of the situation.
I'd like to refer to the discussion we saw and a couple of things that I'd like to share about it. I really appreciate the spirit with which they went ahead and started off with the discussion.
Wonderful.
It was almost an extempore discussion, and they did it well. However, the point of bringing in the discussion about rights, when you say right to offend, somehow I need to understand how the group is evaluating the topic. When you talk about rights, you have to look at what are the rights given to us in the Constitution, right? So it seems that that particular aspect has somewhere been missed.
Mm-hmm.
Because Constitution provides us certain rights. We also have our duties. And when we are talking of right to offend, and in the picture comes Amir Khan, there's something political about the whole direction that it's taking. Can we take up something which is politically motivated in a discussion like this, or are we supposed to avoid this?
We are living in a society which is politically, culturally, socially, economically volatile. And by not touching up on these topics, logically, I think we are not doing justice to our existence. So when I said it was all in jest, I told you Mumbai Literature Festival has just begun today, and this was one topic for discussion, and the panelists are quite eminent people. So it was a fully politically loaded topic, right to offend. Now the treatment that had to be meted out, they did a wonderful job at that. Perhaps due to paucity of time, they may have not included all the points. But even to a very politically loaded topic, we have to take, as we mentioned earlier, a micro and a macro view of the situation. We cannot restrict it. The ambit is immense. So in a group discussion, one thing will get linked to the other, unless and until we are told that we have to look at it through a political lens. We should bring all the points in the discussion. So when we say there were two points, you brought it very well. Right to offend. We should have the right to offend. The word right and the word offend, they had to be primarily explained in the context. And then perhaps we should or we should not could have been discussed. That is why I said for any of these topics, what we could do is we could just in the introduction itself, you could say it has political, socio-cultural, religious impact, and perhaps you can discuss these topics through all these angles. So what you have said is you have opened the forum. Now, points that would filter in would be varied. And for the students, perhaps for you, you would, if you're working for a corporate, if somebody is working for a corporate, the economic and the political aspect would be higher. If you're working in a tribal area, even environmental things would have to be discussed. But otherwise, when we are talking about the students, they want to see how creative their imagination is, how creatively they can bring in points out there. Many a times in a selection process, they would give you 15 minutes. But when they see that the discussion is going on, it's heating up, it's warming up, they allow you extra time also. Okay, so creativity is an extremely important aspect for students also in a group discussion. Have I answered your question?
Well, creativity is fine. Is it not that the right is being construed as liberty in some ways?
So discuss it. You have to bring these into the discussion. Whatever comes to your mind, I think if you have watched my videos earlier, the slides earlier and my video earlier, the very point you've mentioned is there. Whatever, if something strikes you in a group discussion, if something strikes you, don't hold yourself back. Because it could be the very crux of the entire discussion. We normally hold ourselves back. And that point goes to us, to our pillows. Or someone else may have preempted that point, may have thought about it, and he may have mentioned it and he would go away with the credits. So what I personally feel in a group discussion, especially in a group discussion, if something strikes you, it could be mundane, absolutely an absolute disconnect, okay? But if it niggers at you, you could make your point saying, I really don't know if this is directly related to the point or not, if this is really related with the discussion or not, but I just have a feeling that this particular point, mentioned that point, may have an impact. Okay? There may be a couple of them in the group who say, nahi, nahi, aisa kuch nahi hai, this doesn't happen. Right? But there may be others who might have been thinking on those lines and they will give you support. a group discussion is, somebody questioned what is brainstorming, what is group discussion. A group discussion is actually a brainstorming session. Thank you so much for this session.